Mein Name ist Wilfried Tellkemper. Ich bin Direktor bei der Rosa-Luxemburg-Stiftung für den Auslandsbereich und freue mich, dass wir dieses Panel hier in dieser Form zusammengesetzt haben können. Zu meiner Rechten sitzt Leida Reinhout aus den Niederlanden von ANPET. Alle werden sich gleich mit ein paar Worten und ihre Organisation vorstellen. Zu meiner Linken sitzt Nicola Bullard aus den USA. Und dann kommt Stefan Schmalz aus Deutschland. Ich gebe auch gleich das Wort an Leida. Leida wird sprechen über soziale Gleichheit und Umweltgerechtigkeit. Und ich denke, zu deiner Institution und zu dir selber sagst du ein paar Worte.
Thank you very much. I'm going to speak in English because I understand German, but I don't speak it. But as all Dutch people, we think we understand German. So my presentation is about social equity and environmental justice. But first, I want to explain a little bit what my organization stands for. It's ANPET. It's an international network of NGOs working on sustainability, what we call a strong sustainability. So we want to go beyond the eco-efficiency. We are covering the UN ECE region, which means that we have members in Central Asia, Eastern Europe, Western Europe, the USA and Canada. We are based in Brussels. Yes, sorry, I always speak too fast, sorry. So I try to speak a little bit slower, but it's not really my personality. Sorry? Like this? More to, like this? Okay, so I'm not going to repeat what I said already, so I just start with my PowerPoint. It's about social equity and environmental justice, so I will speak a little bit about that. Of course, and then I think our main goal is that we want to have a fair and sustainable economy. Oh yeah, on my screen, it's not everything. So that means that we want quality of life, but within the carrying capacity of the planet, with a lot of participation and, of course, real democracy and justice for all. And as you know, there is no global justice. We still have the fact that there's a lot of overconsumption and a lot of underconsumption. But social equity is a basic need. I don't know if you know the book Spirit Level from Richard Wilkinson. It's a very interesting book because it's clearly shows that where you have social equity, and it doesn't mean if you are rich or poor or whatever, but at least if there is a level of equity in society, then we have just a better life, a better well-being, so less mental illness, violence, and that kind of things. So it's not really so important if we have a wealthy society, materialistic wealth, but it's more important how equal it is. So for me, it's really a basic need. Then if we go to the environmental justice, I just want to start with a development within the limits. You all know the concept of sustainable development. But the day when it went wrong was when the World Bank came with his pillar approach of sustainable development, which gives you the illusion that if you keep on growing and keep on increasing your economic pillar, then you can have money for... So, oh. It makes me afraid. Then you have enough money to invest in your environmental or in your social pillar. So it gives you the false illusion that you can keep on growing, or even that you must keep on growing for investing in your social and environmental issues. So what we do as ANPET, but also we really promote the capital approach of sustainable development, which is, I think, a more realistic approach, because then you can see that your economic activities has to be within the limits of your social capital, because we are all social capital as human beings, but also your level of education, your level of health or whatever, it also has limits. I mean, you cannot work 12 hours a day. I mean, it's just too much for a human being. So we have our limits as well, and of course also within your ecological capital. Then, is growth always positive? Because that's what a lot of people think, and especially, of course, the policymakers, but also a lot of civil society organizations still. In the Lissabon strategy, they say that we have to have a 3% GDP growth per year. But is this sustainable? But also imagine if this little mouse of 100 grams grows continuously with 3%, how much do you think it will weigh after his first birthday? It will become a monster because it will weigh 4,307 kilos. So that means that growth is not always positive. There's nothing in nature that does not stop growing on a certain moment. Then growth, but where? You see here that the high-income countries still have growth, but the middle-income countries and the low-income countries doesn't have any growth. I'm not going to explain this too much, but I think a lot of you are already familiar with it, but the unproductive growth. That means that on a certain point with your GDP growth, it is not productive anymore. It doesn't give you any positive effects anymore. On the contrary, it will give you more negative effects. That means, and Herman Daly calls it unproductive growth. That means that your cost on social issues and environmental issues is higher than your economic profit, let's say. And then, of course, if you see it on global level, you have unequal growth, but also unequal consequences. I mean, the growth is in the north, but the negative consequences are in the south. So that, of course, is nothing on global justice. I think for me, one of the really important things is that we have to go to the redistribution of wealth. I think the only solution to achieve more justice is also poverty eradication by wealth reduction. Because many research work and data tells us that it makes no sense to increase global economic growth. I don't know if you know the New Economic Foundation, but they had a study work on that, that growth doesn't help. Because if you need $1 of poverty eradication in the South, you need an economic growth, a global economic growth of $160 GDP growth. That means that we need 3 or 4 planets more. Only for a kind of poverty reduction. So that doesn't help. So more economic growth will not help for poverty reduction. So the only thing is that if we really want to do something on solving the global justice and having more equity in the world, is the redistribution of wealth. I worked a lot on the issue of ecological debt. It's a concept that came from the South, especially Latin America. And if you have if you read some of this kind of research work, you see that there is still an active process of impoverishment and enrichment that started already 500 years ago, but it's still going on. Ecological debt is accumulating day by day. First of all, exploitation of resources, occupying lands, the land grabbing, environmental damage, waste dumping, biopiracy, and causing climate change. You know all those issues. But it's very important to know that the northern countries live on the account of the resources of the southern countries. And our global economy is already going far beyond the limits of that carrying capacity. Environmental problems are caused mostly because of this, and some social ones as well. I mean, I was this morning also in a workshop on resource conflicts and that kinds of things. So it's really a big issue. And if you are using too much of your natural capital, then any businessman knows that if you start eating your capital, bankruptcy will soon follow. So there is an urgent need to cut down the use of natural resources in absolute amounts. So that goes, especially, of course, in the industrialized world, to sufficiency, a fair share for all. That's why we promote a lot the contraction and convergence. I mean, we have our environmental space. That's, let's say, the fair share for everybody, where everybody has to go, but also that is sustainable. It's a kind of sustainable level. That means that the former Eastern and European countries, but also industrial countries, have to decrease their use of natural resources per person, so that we give space, environmental space, to the developing countries. Of course, they don't have the obligation to grow, but at least they have the right to grow or to use their natural resources that is part of the fair share of the world. The meat of the green economy, you know that a lot of debate has already started on the green economy. It's one of the issues of the next summit. And the green economy is okay. It's, I mean, nothing against it, but if it's not going to solve all the problems on our own. I mean, you have to do more than that. Because it's very easy to fall in the trap of the green marketing. It's just greening the greeds. I think we really have to go to the, as I said already, to the redistribution of wealth as well. Degrowth in the developed countries. That means in the industrialized countries, because eco-efficiency is not enough. We have to go to that sufficiency strategies. One of the things is that we have to recognize and establish the limits, and maybe we have to go to quota for the different natural resources, other indicators, all these kind of things. I'm not going in detail to that, because then I will use the 90 minutes for the whole panel. But I think one... Okay, the problem is that I feel the time pressure from the chair. But this is what was read. Is it okay? No time pressure? Okay, so then you can read. Well, I think one of the most important things that is here and that we want to stress as well is that we want to put limits on wealth as well. So maximum income, other kind of standards as well, product norms. As you look at the product norms at this moment in the European Commission, they're all based on health issue. I mean, some products are forbidden in the European Commission because it's damaging your health. I think it's very important that we also forbid products that is damaging our planet. I mean, it's not only about individual health. I think we have to go broader with that, with the product norms. There is an English report on, I don't know the title, but one of the things they describe very well is the choice editing. I mean, that you as a state or as a government have a kind of framework where you making kind of choice editing so that not the consumer in the supermarket has to do all these kind of decisions, because a lot of this information you just don't have, or you don't have the time to think on every product in the supermarket if you can buy it or not. So there kind of choice editing that the most unsustainable products are just not there anymore. Well, this is Stop the Rat Race. I think something we are in, and it's very difficult to escape from it. I mean, we are all in this. I think even you and me, we're all in this kind of rat race. We feel it, that we have to, of course, you have to work, you have to earn more money, you have to buy and buy and buy, and you will see that you will not, that your happiness will not increase. So one of the things we have to do is dismantling the culture of consumerism instead of only promoting green consumerism. It's not consuming different, it's also just consuming less. Sharing available work, but also urban planning, which allows sustainable transport, the local Agenda 21. Also on education, I think it's very important that we integrate more sustainable development issues, but also on economics in the different levels of education. Also to allow real civil participation so that we also can decide more on what we want and not. And of course, put human values at the heart of every policy. But that asks for leadership, and not only for the governments. It really asks for leadership for the governments as well, but also for civil society. I'm quite frustrated, and don't ask me something about it, because then I will start telling you about the lot of frustration I have with civil society, that they just don't feel responsible for this kind of things, because they're in the same governmental talks as policymakers as well. And that's it. Thank you for your attention.